Well, good afternoon to everyone and welcome to Viewpoint for today. If you're with us by way of TV Carib, Channel 10, we want to welcome you in the audience. And there are those who are with us by way of pj2radio.com as well as 102.7. Good afternoon to all and welcome to the show. All right, I'm here with the Honorable Minister of Finance, Mr. Richard Gibson Senior. And I have to put senior in there because he's in fact the senior. There's a Richard Gibson Jr. I don't want to mix the two. And we'll be talking to him for the whole hour. And of course, get the feeling of where the state of affairs as it relates to our economy is concerned here on St. Martin. Honorable Minister, thanks for taking the time. I know you were already at work for the press briefing and all that kind of stuff. So this is just some additional information, if you will. Thanks for taking the time for being here.
Well, thanks for inviting me, and let me say a good afternoon to all your radio listeners. Glad to be here, and glad to be here to share whatever information you'd like to talk about.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's get started with what you were talking about this morning at the press briefing. What did you say that we don't know?
Well, you wouldn't know because you didn't listen. But those who did not listen...
Yeah.
I reported that, I came back from Curacao last week where I went again for the 3 weeks in a row, actually, and I got an advance of 8 million guilders, which I came back with. It's now on St. Martin's bank account. So that's in addition to the assets division that we had before, for which I came back with 59 million. But there was a separate foundation that was not included, and that separate foundation has a certain amount of money on it, and it has to be liquidated. In advance of the liquidation, an advance of 8 million guilders was paid to St. Martin.
Okay.
But I think that the most important thing, actually the other two things that I raised this morning in the press conference, is equally important in my view. Wendell, as you know, the Central Bank of St. Martin, the branch of the Central Bank of St. Martin, is a branch that does not have the capability to perform the tasks of the Central Bank. All those tasks for many, many years are being performed in Curacao. All of the human resources to be able to perform those tasks are in Curacao. All of the experts, including accountants, including lawyers, including economists, including financial people, all of them are in Curacao. The impact, when you look at the financial statements of the central bank, that has on the economy of Curacao comes up to approximately 60 million guilders. That is the operational costs of the bank, which for a great deal strictly Curacao. So when you look at that impact that it has on the economy of Curacao, it means through the central bank that you have, as far as the GDP in Curacao is concerned, to put it roughly, a 60 million input. And when you compare that with we being part owner of the central bank, you would expect that there would be some kind of fairness in terms of the impact that same central bank that we are shareholder of would have on the economy of St. Martin. Well, it's totally out of whack.
That's not the case.
And it's unfair. It's actually immoral. And that has been going on for many, many years. So I put on my, as they say in Dutch, your bad boy shoes. And I stepped in to the government in Curacao and pointed out to them that this imbalance should end. That, and it should not be dependent on management from the bank or what have you. It should be the shareholders which is St. Maarten and Curaçao, who should make that decision. And I proposed and said to bring an end to this imbalance so that at least proportional to our shareholding in the bank, that we have, in accordance with that shareholding, an impact on the economy of St. Maarten also. In other words, if the operational cost of the bank is $60 million, if we own 20% of the shares of the bank and Curaçao own 80%, then we should see physically and materially a 20% impact of that $60 million into the economy of St. Maarten. If not, then we're not being treated fairly. I got to tell you that the argument was immediately recognized that this is unfair, and immediately recognized and immediately agreed, we have to do something about it. Now, talking about it is one thing, and then you wait and then nothing happens. So we made up a draft agreement. In that draft agreement, it stipulates that the operational costs of the bank that St. Maarten will receive as the budget for the bank, the branch on St. Maarten, to develop the branch of St. Maarten, 20% of the operational costs. Automatically with that, what you will get is 20% of that $60 million is going to be spent on St. Maarten annually, which would then represent 12 million guilders annually that we flow into the economy of St. Maarten. That with that 20%, you would then go and hire economists, lawyers, accountant. And the agreement, draft agreement states that it is the duty and obligation of the central bank to provide the resources, financially as well as human resources, to enable the branch on St. Maarten to function as a full-fledged central bank, to be able to perform all of the banking services that are required for St. Maarten, that the branch of the central bank here will be in a position to carry out those services. So as we speak, the governor in Curaçao, first of all, I should mention that the Council of Ministers of St. Maarten approved the draft agreement here. The Council of Ministers in Curaçao approved the draft down there. And the last lap is we have to get the governors to sign.
Okay.
In the agreement, it states that this agreement will be made available to the new board members of the central bank, management, as well as supervisory board, with the request to implement it as is stipulated in the agreements that both countries are going to sign. Okay. So with that, we have then also ensured that it's not only a verbal discussion or a verbal meeting, but the actual steps to make it happen has also been outlined and will be executed.
All right. Well, that answers the question that I wrote down from the moment you began identifying the imbalance was answered, so I appreciate that. And I realize you're not scripted here, so it means that you're in it full force. That's just an observation that
when you have all the facts and information in your head, you don't have to be scripted in any way. Yeah. You know, you just talk about the facts as you know them.
While you're on it, is there any progress being made, or what is the holdup, if there is one, when it comes to an official currency for both Curaçao and St. Maarten, because that's the way the bank is set up?
Well, we have an official currency, there's no question about it, and that is the existing currency, the Netherlands Antilles guilders. The question is, do we want to continue with a central bank and one currency, or do we want to move to another currency? There has been a lot of discussion about this. There has been a lot of cries in the wilderness about it, but no one yet has made any concrete step to move away from the existing currency one way or the other. And I think that there are advantages and there are disadvantages, and nobody concretely have made up their mind yet, well, which set of advantages and disadvantages they want to go with and rather stay where they are for the time being. As far as the central bank is concerned, part of the problem has been in the past that there's always been a struggle, there's always been discord in appointing members of the central bank, in the board members of the central bank carrying out their duties. I mean, for years, they were squabbling. Last week, the decision was made that we're going to dismiss all of the members of the central bank. In fact, the two members...
Board members you're referring to here.
All of the supervisory board members of the central bank. The two supervisory board members of St. Maarten have already submitted their resignation. The chairman, or the person who was acting as chairman of the supervisory board of directors, appointed by the court, again because of squabbling problems at that time, has also submitted their resignations. There are two board members left, and those two board members have been notified of the intent to have them dismissed as board members. And, of course, following good governance procedure, they're given the opportunity to be heard and to react, and afterwards the decision will be followed. Then we will proceed, and that process is also going, and this time around, we want to have the board members of Central Bank screened.
Okay.
Screened as far as integrity is concerned, and a procedure has also been developed for that.
Okay.
And as we speak, those members are being submitted, so the screening could take place. It will not be a screening as we have for ministers, but it would be a screening that a little less invasive, because the purpose is different. Ministers have to serve the public at large.
Yes.
Board members, supervisory board members have to serve the interests of the bank. So the screening it will be limited as far as they're concerned, but as far as integrity is concerned, they will be screened this time.
Limited to financial aspects.
Right, exactly.
Mr. Minister, how would you describe, let's come home to your politics or local, how would you describe our economy or financial state of affairs right now? I know you submitted an approved a balanced budget, but mention was made of how thin it is. And I know there are most of the ministries, if not all, would like to have more money at their disposal. But general look at the financial affairs of St. Maarten, how does it look in your word? How would you describe it?
I would describe it as on the right path. When I say on the right path, a major part of the problems in the past was fiscal discipline. There was no fiscal discipline. When you have a situation where a government collects premiums for pension and premiums for sickness accident, and instead of paying it out to the insurance companies, but using that to pay electricity bills and to pay salaries and what have you, you know there is no fiscal discipline. And that is only a path that's going to lead to disaster for the people in general. That has changed. There is now fiscal discipline. There is now fiscal discipline from the point of view that the limitations that we have, we recognize, we abide by. The motto that I came out with and I've been saying, listen, you can't spend what you don't have. So that, I think, is a great accomplishment to date. But the fact that you only can spend what you have, which is, you know, your mother always told you that too, you know, you got to, if you spend more than what you have, you're going to end up in debt, and you're going to end up in bankruptcy, you're going to end up in problems. So we're spending now what we have. So we're spending within our means. All right. Now the next step is the amount that we have to spend, like everybody else wants to have more money to spend. All right. The question is, where do you get at more money to spend? It doesn't fall out the sky. If you want more money to spend, it has to be either you're generating it from your economy, you're generating it from taxes, you got to bring new taxes. That's the way you will get or improve your tax compliance. those are the sources where you will get additional money to be able to spend. One of the things that we said from the very beginning is the tax burden is high enough or even too high. So the option of increasing taxes is not on the table because we cannot increase the tax burden towards the population. But what we can do is spread the burden. If we take a look at what the yield is from our tourist industry in St. Martin, and we compare it with the yield of the tourists in Aruba, the same tourists, they have substantially more yield. In other words, those tourists leave substantially more money behind per tourist than St. Martin. And you ask yourself, well, why? Well, if we go and look at it, in Aruba, you go to a hotel and you check it out. The total additional cost to your basic room rent is 21% on top of what your room costs. We go and look at St. Martin, and then you find that St. Martin, government-wise, we have a 5% room tax. That's it, period. Government does not receive anything else. So actually, your room rate at a hotel should be whatever the room rate is, plus 5%.
Correct.
But that's not the case. Here, too, you will find, and some even advertise it, this is your room rate, and you got 18, 19% additionally you put on it. Government only charges 5%, but they tell the tourist, this is
government tax.
Government tax, which is a total misleading the tourist. When you go and look as to what the components is of it, the 5% goes in government coffers. They're supposed to pay. Some of them pay, some of them don't. That's why you got compliance low again. But the rest, they use to pay for their own expenses.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm saying, why is it St. Martin, the government, does not have enough money? One, of course, because of mismanagement in the past. Now, that has been
identified,
basically cured. The second thing is, why don't we have a higher yield? Well, we don't have a higher yield because when you have hotels taken away 19% from the tourists, the government only gets 5% when they pay. So the government probably gets half of that, you know, when you go and look and say, well, what did they pay the 5%? The rest the hotel keeps. So who is depriving government from the income government needs to fulfill the services that the population needs? It's the hotel. So I'm saying, no, you know what we're going to do? We're going to increase the room tax to 10%, from 5 to 10. Then we're going to get a yield. That 10% is, we are the lowest right now in the whole region. If we move it to 10%, we still will be approximately the lowest in the whole region. You see where yield per tourist coming into the coffers of government then provides government with the money. Mm-hmm. I want to take the airport. The airport per passenger charges a departure fee, not a departure tax. Some people call it a departure tax. No, a departure tax is something the government charges and government gets. So this is a departure fee.
Mm-hmm.
If I tell you that they charge per tourist $42 per passenger. And then I said, okay, why is it the yield that we need in government is not here as it is in other islands? Because that $42 is kept by the airport. We get not 1 cent, not a penny.
Yeah.
Not only that, they made a loan. And the loan documents state that as long as that loan is outstanding, you can't get dividends. So, Wendell, does it surprise anybody that government don't have the money to be able to provide the services to the people here when hotels, airport, same thing with the harbor, everybody grabs all the money for themselves, and if you try to get one penny more, you hear all kind of screaming and shouting, no, 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 we can't afford that. We're already charging them departure tax. Yeah, you charging them for your pockets. But if you put in there, you're charging departure fees because of security, because of facility fees, I'm saying government provides more security and more facilities to these tourists than anybody else.
Yeah. Mr. Gibson, I have to take a break, but I'm certainly pleased to know that the government or your ministry is doing what it can to look for ways to be able to raise the type of revenues needed so that our coffers. While going to the break, let me just leave something here, and I want you to answer it when we come back. How would you answer to somebody who says that when you look at the amount of money that is injected into St. Martin's economy, how come the government struggles so much to finance their budget? I want you to answer that when we come back, but let's take a break first.
Hello, St. Martin. This is Mikey Faria of the Napa Auto Truck and Marine Parts Stores with a message for the driver of the green old-style four-door Japanese car, of which the four-number M registration begins with an 8 and ends with a 2. According to our security cameras video, you took custody of all our fancy Exora plants from in front of the Napa Auto Parts store on the Orange Grove Road in Cold Bay between the hours of 1:31 a.m. and 1:36 a.m. on Friday, June 30th. Sir, we beg you, please take good care of our plants. You see, they were with us only 3 weeks, but we were well on our way to raise them like exemplary members of our community. We had already covered the Thou Shalt Not Steal thingy and had just started the integrity, honesty, and fairness lessons our parents, teachers, and pastors instilled in us when you so rudely jerked them up and moved them out in the pouring rain. Hopefully the next time you visit Napa on St. Martin, it is only to purchase Auto Truck and Marine Parts. Napa, where even not-so-nice customers get treated nice. Call us on 542-3555 or 544-3355 if you have a question. Or call 911 to know if the police figured out the other two digits of your license plate.
Are you feeling hungry? Looking for the best grilled sandwiches for breakfast or lunch? Well, Carl's and Sons would be the right choice on both sides of the hill. Carl's and Sons are now offering a wide variety of sandwiches, salads, soups, and daily lunch specials from Mondays through Saturdays. Carl's and Sons, your number one choice for baked goods for over 20 years, serving the island of St. Martin and surrounding islands with quality breads and pastries. Visit us today at Carl's and Sons Unique Cafe on the Pondville Road, Phillipsburg. Carl's and Sons Unique Bakery and Supermarket located in Orange Grove, Cold Bay. Open from 4 to 8 p.m. on Sundays. Or call us at 54-42462 for more information. Carl's and Sons, the right choice.
Are you a casual gamer or just like to have fun in the casino? Rouge Noir Casino hosts an array of activities where gambling fans can chance their luck until the last call is made. They have many games to choose from, including blackjack, poker, roulette, slot machines, baccarat, and live bingo. Join us daily with our live bingo with payouts up to $3,000 daily. While at the casino, enjoy free buffet prepared by top chefs on the island. Yes, every evening, you can enjoy free dinner compliments of Rouge Noir Casino. Spend time with us where you can play, drink, relax, and eat at Rouge Noir Casino. The progressive jackpot is now over $36,000. Rouge Noir Casino, home of the progressive jackpots on Front Street.
Are you building, renovating, or are you a contractor? St. Martin Concrete, your number one concrete provider on St. Martin, wants you to visit them, Organ Pipe Cactus Road in Sucker Garden. They are the specialists in concrete. They have high-performance chemicals like AquaDry waterproof concrete, NitroCore anti-corrosion for steel, and MegaFlow water reducer, all for the prevention of cracks in your concrete. Give them a call today on 543-0164 or 523 3578 and find out more about these high performance chemicals. St. Martin Concrete, where quality is guaranteed.
It's a wireless Watching TV Carib. What? You're making joke.
And welcome back to Viewpoint for today. I'm here with the Honorable Minister of Finance, Mr. Richard Gibson Senior, who is with us for the full hour until news time at 1 o'clock. And while going to the break, I actually would qualify what I said as a statement, really, but it can be formed into a question as well. And the minister said to me, I'm not going to hide this. I just answered that question, but that's okay. But I wanted to make the point that because of the vibrancy of our economy here on St. Maarten, I believe it's generating enough money that we should never have a problem with our budget. I mean, if you want to, Mr. Minister, add anything to what I've just said, or you'd like me to pose another question, I'll be happy to do so.
No, not at all. I'm happy to elaborate on it if that's your intent and purpose, because it's a legitimate question, because a lot of people ask that question. Look at St. Maarten, it's booming, tourists come, cruise ships there, most cruise ships in any other island in the area, what have you. How come the government doesn't have money? Well, what I attempted to do just now is to explain to you the reasons why. The yield from the tourist industry that should be there to reach government coffers do not. Mm-hmm. Why? Because it's taken off the top, it's creamed away by others. And when I said to you that we're the lowest as far as room tax in the whole region, you say, yeah, it wouldn't reach your budget. If I say, listen, you don't have a departure tax, while everybody, even up to Anguilla, has a departure tax, not a fee, that every tourist pay, yeah, we don't get from the $42 at the airport. We don't even get dividends from the airport. So then you can say, well, how come you don't have money in your budget? Well, there I just explained to you why it's not there. So we have to generate revenues, and this is the balancing act that we have to do. We have to generate more revenues for the government coffers without increasing the burden of taxes on the local person. Now, go and use your magic and bring that about. The only way is you got to shift it, like other countries have done, to your tourists. And that's where you see we come in and says, well, we're going to start a departure tax. We're going to increase room taxes because those are all indirect taxes. Mm-hmm. Does not first and foremost burden the local worker, the local citizen of St. Maarten. And through those means, I said to the airport, you got our money. I said to the harbor, you have money that government should be getting. Mm-hmm. Because you take whatever departure fees you charge, you put it in your pocket. We can't get no dividends. So I don't have money for the budget. So we have to do things a little different. I got to do it now through concession fees.
Yeah.
I got to do it through starting a departure tax. I got to increase my room tax instead of having the hotels tell the tourists, mm-hmm. oh, what we charge you now is government tax, and then take the money and put it in their pocket. No.
Mm-hmm.
Don't call something a government tax when you know fully well it's not a government tax. You're defrauding the tourists.
Yeah. But don't you think this, it's important for you to make this point publicly? Because
what,
if
am,
anything,
I doing, what
if,
am I doing now?
If anything goes wrong, it's easy for them to blame you for adding a departure tax to what they've already been paying without people understanding that there are monies that are being collected at the airport that is not being paid to the government. People need to understand this.
But of course, you know, and it will come to Parliament and we'll have a debate on it. I am saying it publicly now. I have said it before in press briefings. So it's not because I am not pointing out these deficiencies, and it's not because I'm not showing the way how we can move forward, because we have to stop living from hand to mouth. We've got to be able to provide the public the services that the public have a right to and deserve. We have to continue balancing our budget, because that's what the law says. It's a kingdom law. So whatever monies you have, that's what you have to live with, because you can't spend more than you earn. So the only way you're going to be able to spend more is that ceiling in revenues have to increase. And by increasing that ceiling, you will have more revenues to be able to take care of these obligations.
The taxes that you're talking about that would probably be added to the room taxes, don't you think that's long overdue too? They've been paying that for many, many years now.
Of course, the 5% goes back, I don't know, for more than 20, 30 years.
Correct.
You know, so. And then we're also the lowest. They would right away admit to you if we're the lowest in the region.
Yeah.
Why would we have to be the lowest? In Aruba, they charge also an environmental tax, a health tax. We're living in paradise here. Paradise from the point of view that the burden, as far as the tourists is concerned, and the general population, is here lower than every place else. Because we don't pay no health tax. We don't pay no environmental tax. We don't pay no 14% sales tax as they do in
other places.
In St. Kitts. You name it. So we need to get real. We have to get in the 21st century. Mm-hmm. And we don't want to be the highest of anybody else, but we can't afford to be the lowest either.
Mm-hmm. What about the tax project, tax office project that you've been working on? You've spoken about it, and I think you have also alluded to the fact that it would stimulate compliance. What about it that we don't know, that we need to know?
Yes, well, the business plan is being prepared, has been prepared, is being fine-tuned now. The business plan for that was necessary because the CFT, who has indicated that they will approve the loan for us to be able to overhaul the entire tax department, requires a business plan and requires also that a second opinion be given that business plan. So that's what we're waiting on. As far as capital expenditures, we're moving with to something else. The capital expenditures for this year, 2017, has also already been approved by CFT. We're waiting on one letter because the central bank had written and asked for that letter, and then government could start spending the capital expenditures for 2017 that they earned by balancing the budget. Taxes, tax-wise, we are at the point where we have to revamp the tax department. I mean, we are the lowest, as far as tax compliance is concerned, in the entire region. It's so low, it's embarrassing.
Okay.
So we don't want to increase no taxes, but at least we want to be able to collect the taxes
due to government
that's owed. And you have situations here, and I might as well talk about it, that when you talk about compliance, you have all kind of games and tricks that are being used. There's some business places you go into and they have 2 and 3 credit card machines. One credit card machine is for the sales they want to register. The other one is registering the name of a company in Anguilla outside the island, and those sales are not registered. This is fraud. People will go to jail if they're caught with this thing and evidence can be provided. That is what causes the 21% non-compliance as far as taxes are concerned. We have to get hold of this, and to do that, you have to have an infrastructure, you have to have human resources, And those human resources with this loan that we're getting for revamping the tax department, because it's not only including a building to stop the going from one place to the other, everything under one roof, IT, computers, but also human resources, inspectors and so forth, we can get to the bottom of these problems that I'm pointing out to you.
Mm. All right. And how do you respond to those people who think that a lot of capital flight goes on here as well, people who makes money here and it's never deposited here?
Well, that would bring me to another issue, and that has to do with January 1st, 2018. The common reporting system goes into effect. Now, what is the common reporting system? The common reporting system is a treaty signed by most countries in the world that's going to require that anyone having monies anywhere who is registered here, that those countries, or those financial institutions in those countries, will automatically report to the tax department here on St. Martin, or to each other's tax department, that you have an account and how much money is in that account. That goes into effect January 1st, 2018. Now, if I come back to you and you talk about, yeah, the money's not deposited here, it doesn't elsewhere, it don't matter. No matter where you deposit, it comes to service. And then the tax department has to be in a position to get active to find out, well, partner, did you pay your share in taxes? Have you, those monies that you have there, how did you generate it? And all we're interested in knowing is, did you pay your fair amount of taxes? Now, in that connection, I've also mentioned this before, that there's legislation that have been submitted to give the opportunity to people to declare taxes that they have cheated in the past. They will then not be fined. They will get a reduced rate, 15%, as long as they use another 15% to finance a development bank for St. Martin. So you're killing three birds with one stone. You have monies that you didn't declare. You can't hide it anymore come January. So I'm giving you opportunity to not to be exposed to fines and what have you and nightmares. Still come in and say, listen, yeah, I have that. You know, I didn't declare it. You get a reduced rate of 15%. A reduced rate, so not the normal rate. Mm-hmm. We're giving you a break. But you have to participate in the shares of the development bank, because it's time that we also have a development bank. A development bank is meant to develop projects that normally, because the risks are attached to it, will not be financed by a commercial bank. Mm-hmm. The development bank has one thing in mind. Is that project going to create employment? Is that project going to create know-how? Is that country going to be beneficial to the country? So you see, there are other considerations that the development bank uses to fund projects than a commercial bank. Most countries have a development bank. We don't. We have one in name. It's in Curacao. Mm-hmm. But what does it do for us? It doesn't do anything for us. So that opportunity to at least have some development through a development, we don't have. So we want to do one now, and we want to get it capitalized and funded through the system, and the legislation is in the pipeline.
All right. Wow. Okay. Thank you so much for sharing that. And, well, I'm almost sure that those people who are listening would want to use this opportunity to get themselves even. You know, I can't let you go without finding, or at least getting out of your brains, a little bit of the intentions of the law school. You've talked so much about it and what it means. But we have an issue when it comes to languages. And I'm wondering if that is factoring anywhere in this whole concept, because I believe we have few people who show interest primarily because everything is in the Dutch language. is there any, we're moving away from the finances aspect.
That's all right.
I'm talking a little bit about this law school because I believe we need a lot. There's going to be a lot of opening. I've talked about it so very much. A lot of opening for people with a legal background. And these offices, again, we might have to be going to Suriname and Curacao and Aruba and Holland to look for people to fill these when we can have our own local resource to be able to fill that. But is the language, is anything of the language taken into consideration?
Look, a law school, by definition, is a law school so that you can produce people who can be lawyers here, who can sit on the benches of the court here, who can be prosecutors, who, in addition to that, serve the economy in other capacities as advisors to banks, financial institutes. The law school is so important because if you look historically, we're not producing these people. Mm-hmm. It's only sporadically, once in a while, we get somebody. But to sustain the economy, as you can see, because we are not producing those people, the economy still needs those people, so we have to get all of them from the outside. If you are going to study law, it has to be Dutch law, because not British law, which is a different kind of law than ours is. So I don't see it as a problem. From the point of view is, one, you have to understand, you have to learn to speak Dutch. We're going to accommodate English instructions as much as we can. In fact, many universities in Holland, the center of the Dutch environment, gives instructions in English, because English is the language that everybody's embracing. But you cannot change the Supreme Court. You cannot change all of the laws. So you're going to have to, besides English, also speak Dutch at a level that you can write it. So what are we doing in the law school? We're going to open the law school for those who qualify right now, who have the educational background and so forth, to immediately start. We also know that we have to have a pool of people who wants to, who desires to, and we've got to make it possible for them, if we want to really tackle this problem completely, that they can go through a program that they can qualify to get into the law school. Mm-hmm. So it's a two-stream program that we're having in this law school. In that program, Dutch will also feature as a language that you have to learn. So whether you speak English, French, German, that's fine. But the instruction is going to be given in English, also in Dutch, and Dutch is going to be a requirement. So if you're serious,
yeah,
and you can't be serious that you want to become a lawyer in a Dutch territory but not speaking Dutch. So if you're serious, you got to calculate, okay, I will have to start learning Dutch and through a couple of years you get to a level. And it happens all the time. It's nothing new. What I want to say as far as the law school is concerned, to show you why it is an obligation which you have, because look around you and see who are the people sitting on our benches. Now, if you don't do something about that, they're not going to do something about it. If you're waiting for them to do something, it's not going to happen. Look at who we have as prosecutors. If you want that to change, you have to do something about it. They're not going to do something about it because they are where they're happy to be.
Yeah.
You know that education, to avoid people of color from breaking through to certain levels in society, they deprive them of education. Because the more they deprive them of education, they know then you're going to be dependent. From that point of view alone, it should motivate and spur any and everybody who qualify to take this road to make certain that you don't become dependent and forever depends on them. Because I heard, you know, there's some people talk about we got to go independence or what have you. And right away, I said, independence with who? Who are going to be your people sitting on your benches in your corporations? Who? Where are they? And then there's no answer to that. Then you got to say, well, we got to import them. Well, you got them already imported. No, we've got to create them. Mm. That's the road we've got to go to make sure that we don't be dependent.
Mr. Gibson, I really do appreciate the fact that you could spend this time with me. And more so because I had no influence in getting you here, but I'm happy to have you nonetheless. And I can't let you start speaking anymore because I'm out of time, basically. What would be your final word?
My final word, just to pick up on what you said, to avoid any kind of misunderstanding and that, you had no influence in getting me here, but one of your staff members is the one who I know, and she's the one who asked me to be here, and that's why I come, and I was glad to be here upon the invitation from your station, and I'm glad to be speaking to your members, and I hope that some of the information I've been able to share will be useful to them.
To be honest with you, what is most important is that the people who listens to this program, as well as the general public of St. Martin, is informed with the type of information that would help them to reach to a point where they can make an informed decision when it comes to their civic responsibilities. And I do appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
Well, thank you so much for coming. Yeah. All right, folks, that's going to be the end of it for today. We are going to be back here tomorrow, hopefully God's willing, and we invite you to join us then. From all of us, thanks for listening. I want to thank Mr. Gibson once again for coming in and sharing with us. Until tomorrow, bye-bye.
Is the voice of St. Martin, PJD2, 1300 AM, broadcasting from Plaza 21, Phillipsburg, St. Martin. The World News is next on the voice of St. Martin.
Hello, this is Charles Carroll with the BBC News. President Trump has described his son Donald Jr.'s account of his meeting with a Russian lawyer as open, transparent, and innocent. The president's son has appeared on US television to defend his actions during last year's election campaign when he was told the lawyer had information from the Russian government to help his father's bid for the White House. Mr. Trump Jr. told the Hannity program the meeting had been somewhat misleading.
I think what happened, he sort of goosed up, he built up. There was some puffery to the email, perhaps to get the meeting, to make it happen. And, you know, in the end, there was probably some bait and switch about what it was really supposed to be about. And so, you know, there is nothing there.
Some of the world's biggest internet firms, from social networks to pornographic sites, will join a protest later today against US proposals to roll back the rules on net neutrality, the equal treatment of internet traffic. Here's Dave Lee in San Francisco.
As it stands, net neutrality means internet services are not allowed to block content or prioritize companies that have paid extra for quicker loading times. Desperate to protect that principle, household names like Facebook, Twitter,